75 feet.
To the creek.
And maybe we'll get home and watch it.
My neighbor called me one
day. Oh, is it our game
line? You better get on there. And we'll get home and have fire between the creek and your house. So it's burning right up at your wall.
Let me add that rub man.
I didn't mean to say that after.
You
go ahead and get started and be thinking.
Okay.
I'm gonna get out of your way over here.
Okay. Good evening. My name's Gretchen Quarterman, and I live halfway between here and the base. Answer that. Where are you from? I live halfway between here and the base. I'm originally from the Niagara Falls area. That's why I don't talk like I'm from here. I've been living here a while. I'm currently the acting executive director of the Walls Watershed Coalition, and I have a little slideshow which doesn't show up if we have the lights on. So I'm going to turn the lights off, which is right there. So can everybody see that?
Yep. All right.
The Walls Watershed Coalition is also the Suwannee River Keeper. And not just the Suwannee River in Florida, but the entire Suwannee Basin. So from Cordele, with the headwaters of the Withlacoochee and the 11 Valley up in that area, and the Suwannee, which has the headwaters over at the swamp. And that big basin like this in Georgia, then comes down to the confluence of the Withlacoochee with the Suwannee, and then flows as the Suwannee to the Gulf. So that's sort of the area that we're talking about. This is a picture taken last January on one of our rivers. Does anybody recognize that river?
Withlacoochee.
The little river. It's the little river just below 122. So we have an outing on the rivers every month as an awareness so that people can learn to appreciate the rivers. And we travel among the rivers, so sometimes we're on the Little River, sometimes we're on the Arapaho, sometimes we're on the Suwannee. In the wintertime, when the water is nominally higher, we try to go to the rivers upstream rivers because there's less water up there in the summertime. Then in the summer, we're down at the bottom of the river during this month. So Walls is a Waterkeeper member. The Waterkeeper Alliance is an international organization, and it assigns territories. And we incorporated as the Walls Watershed Coalition in June of 2012. And at that time, we couldn't decide whether we wanted to join this group or not. There were some questions about what did a waterkeeper have to do. And we said, we just want to be an educational organization to help people appreciate and protect our rivers. But as time went along, we realized that there were going to be some big advantages to affiliating with the waterkeeper organization. And we became an affiliate last year. And an affiliate status, you pay your dues. And you get to go to the conference, pay your own way. And you have some of the resources. But when you become a full member, one of the things that you get is you really get your territory assigned to you, and you become a river keeper. And the river keeper has the job of holding polluters accountable and really making sure that our rivers, which are very beautiful rivers, stay as beautiful as they are. So we are now the Suwannee River Keeper. Another thing is that we have, a river keeper is a person. And so our board of the Walls Watershed Coalition, which is a 501c3, has designated a person as the Suwannee River Keeper. And that person sitting right there, John Quarterman, is the Suwannee River Keeper. That's his job.
I'm here for show and tell.
Good job.
So there are water keepers and river keepers all in Georgia. And this is sort of, you can see this map. This is Atlanta up here, and this is the Flint River, and this is us, and St. John's, and St. Mary's, and the Savannah River Keeper. And so they're all around us. And until we formed, there was a big gap in our area. Nobody was really advocating for our rivers. So this is dim, sorry. This is a map of our territory. So we go all the way from Cordial up here, over to the swamp. If this is blurry looking to you, is it blurry looking to me? Is that blurry?
It's blurry.
I'm gonna fix it.
Need focusing a little bit.
Is that better?
It's still blurry to me, my eyes might be bad.
Might be my glasses. You should stop wearing my glasses.
That's a good possibility, man.
There, that's better.
Anyway, so, start with
like
cataract.
It's big, like this.
Don't make me think I'm losing it.
And goes down to the Suwannee. So, the well's vision, so if you said, what's the vision of your organization, is for a healthy watershed with clean, swimmable, fishable, drinkable water. That's our vision. That's what we want to have in the big picture. We want to have, when you go to the river, it's safe, it's clean, it's fun. Our mission is that Wells Watershed Coalition advocates for conservation and stewardship. So we're going to be good stewards of the resources we have available for us. For now you'll find out where Wells came from. Withlacoochee, Willacoochee, Alapaha, Little, and Suwannee Rivers. The watersheds in South Georgia and North Florida through education, awareness, environmental monitoring, and citizen activities. When we engage people in activities around the rivers, whether it's boating or fishing or swimming or a fishing tournament or going to the swamp and bird watching or picking up trash, those are all educational also. So our board was formed in 2012, and one of the reasons why we formed was we looked at where data was coming from in Georgia about water quality issues, and there was no data being collected here. There just was a giant gap, no little data points. And one of the first things that we did was we got trained to do water quality testing. Then we found out that you need an army of people to be able to do that correctly. So that's one of the projects that hopefully our riverkeeper will be able to expand with us, to find volunteers who will go and collect the water so we can have regular ongoing water quality monitoring. We have quarterly board meetings in there throughout the watershed. We often meet in Adel because it's about halfway, but our next one is coming up on Thursday and it's going to be in Live Oak. And after that meeting in Live Oak, we're going to have a public meeting. And the public meeting is going to be about people who are concerned about the pipeline crossing the Suwannee River. And it's going to be the Sierra Club, our Santa Fe River people, people from both the camps in Florida. Who else?
Got some people coming up all the way from South Florida and Atlantic. They're forming a thing called the Water Protector Alliance for water groups all over Florida. There already is something like that in Georgia. It's called the Georgia Water Coalition. We're, of course, a member of that. And there's some other speakers, so you might find it interesting.
That's going to be on Thursday 18th after our board meeting.
Where's the pipeline going to cross at?
Oh, I'll talk about that. So, when we started out, we had three goals, and they were advocacy, conservation, and something else. But we found that we needed to have a little bit finer-grained goals. So we have the goal of education, and it's education both of the public that live in our area and also of other places about our area, because our area is very special. We have black water rivers, which means we have low dissolved oxygen in our rivers because of the leaves and the tannins. And when people look at our rivers and they see that beautiful brown color, they go, oh, your water's brown. Like, oh, no, it's supposed to be that way. So the education is both ways, to educate our own people, but to educate people from away about our rivers. To be a knowledge resource. Again, for people in our area, we're a resource where they can come and ask us questions, and we're a resource for people from away to say, well, what is it like in your area, and what is it that you do? So people can come and ask us. To do water quality testing, that's a really important thing, and it's one of the projects that we hope to get going. To collect documentation, to document, one of the, so here's one of our documentation programs. Conference. This is, I've got some of these around, the Alapaha River Water Trail brochure. And so this was one of our very first projects, documentation about the rivers. So there's all different kinds of documentation of what's happening, but that's one of our projects. And it was one of our very first projects. I have a whole slide about that coming up, but holding polluters accountable. Could you guys like listen to me? Water keepers hold polluters accountable. So identifying the threats and addressing them is something that's important to do.
Do you mind if I ask?
No, go ahead, ask a question.
How do you do that?
Mostly people call us up.
Okay.
Is
there somebody to report?
Well, yes, there's channels to go through. And one of the things that there's a tool that we're trying to get hooked up to us, it's called Muddy Water Watch. So that when you see a violation, say when somebody's doing construction and they're supposed to have their silt fences up, if the silt fences aren't right, you can report that. Hopefully we're going to get that configured for our area so that you can do it on your phone, automatically report, this isn't right, there's a water overflow, somebody's draining something they shouldn't, and you can just report it directly. For now, you can just call us or mail in on the website, and then we try to help make things sure they get to the right place, that they get reported to EPD or that they get to the county or wherever it's supposed to go.
Y'all ever met Joe Freeman with Georgia EPD? Well, he has to move around a lot because he covers 34 counties. But that's basically who he ended up reporting things to about water right now, which is one reason a group like this is important, because obviously Joe Freeman can't see everything. So if all of us can help him out, that's a good thing.
Yeah, and he appreciates that too, because with 34 counties, he can't inspect every little bit of it. And then engage our community outdoors, you know, to have outdoor activities. Somebody posted somewhere lately and said, what did you like to do the most as a kid? And I was like, run around outside. What are you kidding? I loved to be outside when I was a kid. And now as a grown-up, I still love to be outside. And it's really what makes me happy. And I hope that we can make other people happy by engaging them in the outdoors and helping to appreciate that. And then the last thing, as you all know, you have a nonprofit here at the Historical Society. Raise money to support all those things that are above. So lots of other organizations already promote paddling, swimming, fishing, birding, other water-related activities, and Walls does hook on an education. But we exist to assist in positive changes and to resist problems. So we try to be proactive, making sure that bad things don't happen. Right now, we don't have any single polluter in our, like on the Alapaha. The Alapaha doesn't have one single polluter. It has non-point source polluter, so we can't really identify who's the polluter. That's sort of a different problem. a few single point source problems. It's not all preservation and protection. We don't necessarily want to keep things exactly the way that they are now. We want them to be as healthy as possible. Conservation connection to our rich local history and introducing new paddlers. So probably if you grew up in Hay-Hiram, you remember swimming either in the Little River or the Withkuchi. And you have special places that you have in your memory. We want to make those same memories for kids that are growing up now. But we need to make sure that the rivers are safe. Fishing, swimming, boating. One of the problems that we have in the rivers now, we see it when we go down, is invasive species. We see privet, we see climbing fern, we see hydrilla, and those are things that we need to make go away. We need to make them go away in a positive way, not in a polluting way. Oh, this is going to run way longer than I ever thought. The water trails I handed out there, the brochure for the Alapaha. So we had a student art contest to come up with that logo. We engaged high school students from across the area to get that logo. In the 1970s, there was an Alapaha River water, River Trail brochure here. So that's sort of a historical documentation knowledge base that we're collecting. The difference in the maps, you can see sort of the old fashioned, and now our map is completely online, so you can go to our website and you can zoom in and see features on the river. The Hamilton County Tourist Council pay for an additional 5,000 of those to be printed. Our initial printing was 5,000, and we had received money from Lowndes County Tourism, Hamilton County Tourism, and the Georgia River Network to print the original 5,000. And then Hamilton County paid on their own to have 5,000 more printed because they liked it so much. The boat ramp at Old State Road in Naylor was closed several years ago, and we lobbied the county commission to put on the SPLOST referendum that we voted a couple years ago to build a boat ramp at Naylor. So they purchased property at Naylor at 84 to build a boat ramp. It's 3.5 acres?
4.5.
It's 4.5 acres. I talked to the engineer today that's working on that project, and they haven't been able to get a bid that fits in the budget that they have.
They hadn't got a boat ramp down there yet?
No, not yet.
For public, yeah.
But
they're going to have access to where it can get off of 84.
Where you can get off of 84, you'll have to be coming from the east, you know, towards the west to turn.
You can actually go in there now and use the river.
Yes.
It's just the riverbank, you know, boat ramp.
You cross over the river here, and they're going to make a nicer entrance. Right now, you just like made a hard right, and you go boom, 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 down the side. But they're going to make a parking ramp and a real boat ramp where you can take a trailer down there and put a real boat in.
Yeah, that's what I'd like to put a real one in there.
They're going to put a real one in. They're working on it. So our next project is the Withlacoochee and Little River Water Trail. There's 2 dozen access points. There's a couple of Valdosta Lowndes Parks and Recreation parks and ramps. There's two rivers, the Little River and the Withlacoochee. So you have the two of them coming down and then joining down by Valdosta and going down to the Suwannee. There's two states, same as the Alapaha, you have Georgia and Florida. And then we have the issue of 9/11 consistency. When we called the different counties and we said, what do you call those boat ramps or those bridges or there's something, everybody gave a different name. So okay, that's the first thing we have to do is we have to make sure that when people go in and if we have a sign that says so-and-so boat ramp, everybody's calling it the same thing. So if you have a problem, you can say, I put it in a place and 911 knows how to help you. So that's our current little problem. Again, we had a contest. This time, college students designed us that logo, the Withlacoochee and Little River Water Trail logo. And again, there was in the 1970s a Withlacoochee River Water Trail brochure. So our brochure, which will be like this one for the Alapaha, but for the Withlacoochee, is a follow-on to the water trail that was already there, sort of a 4 years later update using new technologies. We do have widespread problems, though. We have deadfalls. Go down the Little River. You might as well be walking, carrying over. We have some clear cutting. Most landowners are okay, but some do cut right up to the bank, and they're not supposed to do that. We have wetlands destruction. You can see that all around when they cut down the swamp on Valdell. That was sort of a, you know, not actually supposed to do that. The buffers aren't always what they're supposed to be. Invasive species I already talked about. And impervious surfaces. Lowndes County is now big enough that because we're metropolitan statistical area that we have rules we're supposed to follow about when water comes down from the sky, it's not supposed to leave the property. But the counties upstream from us, because they're small, they don't have those rules. So when they pay, that water can go off the property. And when it goes off the property, eventually it comes to the river. In 2009, when we had the big flood, we had a 500-year flood. But we didn't have a 500-year rain, and maybe a 50-year rain. But because of all that rain in the upper parts of the watershed, the amount of change from the way the world originally was with trees, now it has farms and strip malls and houses, all that water came down to the rivers and overtopped us. We have erosion, see it everywhere. Sediment buildup, so sometimes things run off of fields into the river, or the river changes and there's sediment buildup and then there's flooding. Pesticide runoff, forest flooding, wastewater, oh, wastewater spills. Valdosta got a new wastewater treatment plant, so I have a little bit to say about that in a minute. So the biggest population center in the Suwannee River Basin. What's the biggest population center?
Valdosta.
Yeah.
Valdosta.
Over here, over here.
I said Valdosta.
Oh yeah, that's correct.
I thought it was Ahern.
The biggest city in the watershed is Valdosta. So you say, well, because we don't reach all the way to Gainesville. Gainesville's not in our watershed. The biggest county is Lowndes County. So we have a real responsibility here in Lowndes County, Hiram, Naylor, Reamerton, to take care of our river. So the wastewater treatment plant in Valdosta, it overtopped a couple of times, they had to shut it down, it was flooding, blah, blah, blah. People from as far away as Atlanta and all of the everybody downstream on the Suwannee wanted to sue the city of Valdosta. They're like, you have to make that stop. We said, well, wait a minute, before you start suing people, maybe we could have a meeting and the city of Valdosta could explain what they're going to do. And then, if you want to sue them, you can do that. But let them explain first. So we facilitated this meeting in 2015, and that was when they were going to start building the plant, the new plant and everything. So now here in 2016, Valdosta city staff gave us a really great presentation about the new wastewater treatment plant, their stormwater management, how they're doing it different now, what things they still have problems with. But over a many year, this has been going on, we're seeing good results from Valdosta. It's not perfect, but it's better. We have pros and cons. We can do things that are positive, and we can resist things that are bad. I talked about water trails, boat ramps, renewable energy, water quality testing, resisting invaders, coal plant mercury. So the coal plants around the country are being closed because we have better, cleaner sources of energy. But one of the problems is that coal ash was stored in ponds next to coal plants. So the part of the coal that didn't burn was put in a pond and then water was sprayed on it and just kept it from flying away. And they kept it in ponds. Now they have to close those ponds. Sometimes those ponds spill into the water bodies that are next to them, like what happened at TVA up in Tennessee sometime back. So when that coal ash is concentrated toxins, they have to get rid of it somehow. Some of those from TVA was brought to our landfill here in Lowndes County and spread on the internal roads. Not such a great idea. Some of the coal plants want to bury their coal ash in Wayne County over east of us. And the people over there, that's in Satilla's watershed, they're not too keen on that. We don't want to have that happen by us either. We don't want coal ash to come into our community.
Who authorized it to come here?
Well, our landfill is privately owned, so the landfill can take whatever they want.
And you can't find out what they want.
That's correct.
I thought they made concrete blocks out of fly ash.
They may, but there was actually TVA coal ash that was shipped into the landfill in Lowndes County and just spread on the landfill. Plus, they got a variance to put it on the roads inside the landfill site.
Oh, my Lord.
Which is a quarter mile uphill from the Withabuzi River.
And they also do supposedly make concrete out of it, you know, turn it into roads and stuff. But there's not any long term to say, well, what happens when that road isn't anymore? What happens to those toxins? Or do they leach away from the road? And
probably.
One of the reasons why you have to think this is a problem, we sit on the really large freshwater lake called the Florida Aquifer. It's a giant lake, and we all have a straw down into it. Whether you're drinking city water or private well, your straw goes into the Florida Aquifer. And toxins percolate down into that. And so we don't want to be drinking poisons. They come not only from a coal plant with mercury, the pipeline that's proposed to cross the Suwannee is making sinkholes. As they're building it, sinkholes are appearing. Well, what happens when that, whatever it is that they put in the pipe, goes into a sinkhole and goes into the aquifer? The Florida DEP has done some dye tests. They put dye in, and they say, we think it'll come out over there. And then it comes out in places where they don't expect. They don't really understand how the water flows in the aquifer underneath us. There's different layers of the aquifer. There's like this top limestone, and then there's farther down. And some of that is compartmentalized, but some of it isn't. And so the water moves freely among the levels. You have to be so careful. Agricultural runoff, I mean, we agriculture is our lifeblood here. We're agricultural community. But we have to make sure that runoff, in terms of chemicals, fertilizers, and not just nitrogen, but potassium and phosphorus, that makes its way down the river. We have algal blooms down in the Suwannee. It's a problem. Landfill contents, we haven't talked about that. So here's the Sable Trail Pipeline. That picture is taken exactly at the place where it's going to cross at the Suwannee State Park.
You know where the Withlacoochee joins the Suwannee? Mm-hmm. And the Suwannee River State Park's there. Mm-hmm. The main entrance is on the Suwannee campsite. Okay, most people don't know the park continues upstream for about 2.7 river miles, I guess I memorized.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's no, most people don't know that, but it does. And right at the top end of the park, the pipeline's actually going to drill under the park. They're drilling the pilot hole right now. They're drill under the park, under the river. Well, actually, they're drilling the other way. They're drilling from Suwannee County, under the river, under the park, coming back up to Fellow's Field. The fellow who owns the field is not happy. They used him as their name to make him give them the right of way. The fellow who owns the drill site on the Suwannee County side, he's a well-known lawyer in Florida who does a lot of cases in the Florida Supreme Court. He opposed that thing tooth and nail the whole time, but he couldn't stop it either.
Wow.
We're still trying to stop it.
We're still trying. Okay, so the Florida aquifer doesn't stop at the state line. It starts being recharged up around Albany, and water that falls on the ground up there comes into the aquifer, and people all the way from Albany to Orlando drink out of that same lake. It doesn't care about state lines. So last year in Florida, Walls, on behalf of our Florida members, made an administrative appeal. We asked the state of Florida to say, we think that you didn't do, that Florida DEP didn't follow their own rules correctly. We think that you didn't give the Suwannee River the consideration that it deserves and that you're supposed to by law, Florida law. And we said our concerns are that there could be a frack out into the river and fracking fluid where they make the drill under the river to push the pipe through could come up into the river or it could go down into the aquifer. Because everybody knows there are vents in the bottom of the river where cold water comes up. Those are springs come up. That water flows both ways. And sinkholes could form. I mean, we see sinkholes forming, Shiloh, right? Shouldn't Shiloh have a sinkhole problem over here? There's what they call the little sinkhole trail that runs from here over towards Cat Creek. And the pipeline crosses places where sinkholes are a lot. What are you going to do if you have sinkholes? So we didn't win. The judge said we didn't have standing, we didn't have enough members, not enough of our people were affected by this, and besides which, Sable Trail said that would never happen. Okay. But when they drilled into the Withlacoochee just down by 84, it happened. This is a picture of their fracking fluid. That yellow is their little balloon trying to contain it in the river. So their drilling mud that was supposed to stay under the river came up into the river. In our own beautiful river.
That's about 2,000 feet north of the US 84 bridge. You can actually see that site from the bridge. And the only reason we know about this is one thing that we do. We fly over from time to time in a small aircraft. And I was flying over and I saw, what is that yellow thing in the river? If we hadn't happened to be flying over the day after the frack out, and if I hadn't happened to look right there, They would have got away with it. Nobody would have known.
Is anybody overseeing these people?
Well, they have to make a bi-weekly report, but other than that, no, they just have to every other week give a report of what they did. And so if they did this, they have to report that they did it, but already then it's too late. They made this mess.
DEP knew about it.
How many gallons of tracking fluid did they lose?
I don't know the answer.
Well, we don't know. They didn't say. It's drilling mud, which is bentonite clay, which is not, not the nastiest stuff. On the other hand, it depletes oxygen in water that's already oxygen. But the main point is, they claim, and Florida Department of Environmental Protection, their one witness said under oath, it's not going to be a problem because drilling from upland to upland.
Yeah, it's not going to happen.
The same technology as the slime.
Yeah, so the concern now is that this is going to happen to the Suwannee. The Suwannee is an outstanding river of Florida. Everybody in America knows the Suwannee River. We can't have this. We can't have this happen to our own Withlacoochee. It's wrong.
The other thing about this site is I got Joe Freeman to come down there with EPD and two Sable Trail guys, and we were all standing there beside the river, and I asked them, so do you know where else it might have gone underground? And all they could do is all three of them just shook their head. Because they don't know.
They don't know.
And we won't know until it comes up in somebody's well.
Right. Well, and we know that things go downwards here because of, we know the Shiloh sinkhole. Mm-hmm. Right? Shiloh keeps sinking down and down and down. So we know that stuff goes down. We know that. So the bentonite could have gone down.
Or the river water could leak down and come up in Stone Creek, where the county's already had to pay for fancy equipment because there's already some river water leaking in there.
Well, or in the well at Kinderloo. You know, the county has a well over by Kinderloo. And they paid to have river water out of the well at Alapaha Station. At Alapaha. What do they call that? That development over on the Alapaha.
Lake Lapaha.
That well was contaminated with river water. So the way that you treat groundwater is different than surface water. And when the two mix, then it's a problem. So what are we doing? Awareness, mapping, brochures, outreach to schools, or some of our students that receive prizes, environmental monitoring, water quality, invasive species, turning education into action. We've been doing seminars, so we've had water trail seminars in 2014 and 2016. Tom Baird, who is a historian, a river historian, has talked to us twice about the history of the river and the geology and the fossilized coral, and he's just such a great speaker. The VSU geology professors have talked to us several times. The Valdosta City staff have talked to us about stormwater and stuff. And then we do trash pickups. That's our most recent trash pickup. We picked up at Barron Beach. In an hour, we picked up 2 truckloads of trash. That's a real problem. Non-point source trash is our biggest problem. We don't know where it came from. When somebody throws a cigarette butt or a can or whatever out the car window, that eventually makes its way to the river. It doesn't just stop. It flows down. this is an important thing. So we're part of several networks. We're part of the Georgia Water Coalition, which is groups all across Georgia who form together to have that organization make sure that the legislature doesn't make laws that hurt our water. So it's a lobbying organization that we're all members of. We belong to the Georgia River Network, which is all of the rivers have some representation in this. And the Georgia River Network receives grant money from the Mott Foundation. And they, in turn, re-grant that. We received a Mott re-grant this year to do 2 things. To do community outreach, like what we're doing today, to help us do advertising, buy this new groovy little camera that I got so I can do presentations, and then also to help farmers find EQIP grants that will help them stop runoff, keep silts and pesticides out of the rivers. And so that's one of the projects that we're actively working on and looking for people to work with to help them get EQIP grants. E-Corp grants are available, just a matter of identifying projects to be funded. And we're here to help do that. So if you know people that would benefit from money that could help them replant a buffer along the river or change the way that they're farming their field to build some terraces or something, we can help them through that process. Because the cleaner we keep the rivers, the cleaner our environment. This year is going to be our fifth annual Big Little River Paddle event at Reed Bingham State Park. This is one of our fundraisers. People register to be in this race. There's a $100 prize for the person that gets down the river the fastest. It's 3 miles, and the fastest I've ever done it is in about 58 minutes. Our winner, though, has done it in 32 minutes.
He wins every time.
He wins every time. Although he almost got beat this time.
Have you ever seen the...
Actually, he's just a little muscle man in a kayak. But a canoe, a man and woman in a canoe almost beat him this last year. So this will be our fifth year, and this year we're adding some... we're going to have a silent auction and a barbecue at the end. So we'd love to have you join us on April the 29th at Reed Bingham. You can either... it's a paddle event. Not everybody races. Some people just paddle for the fun of paddling. And we do it, and we split the money with the Friends of Reed Bingham. So it's a joint thing with that. And this is the finish line at the one we're finished at the race. And this is our contact information. I'm Gretchen, that's John. You can, our phone numbers are on there, and you can go to our website, which is WWALS, that's the names of our rivers, .net, walls.net. WWALS.net. And I have our most recent newsletter. And membership information. If you'd like to become a member. Newsletters?
The newsletter lists other outings this week, this coming weekend on the Little River. Starting at 76, Cook County Landing, down to 122. Going to be a little paddle right there on the Little River, starting at 10 a.m.
10 o'clock on Saturday, yeah, we're paddling on the Little River. It's an easy paddle if you've never been before. You could come with us. I didn't leave any over here.
You said earlier that Valdosta explained or gave you an explanation of their progress or whatever.
They did, and in fact that presentation is on our website. If you go to our website, all of the videos, try to take a video of everything that we do so that people that can't come can find out about it later. That presentation was videoed and is on our YouTube channel, so you can go and...
I was just going to ask, were you satisfied with the progress?
Yes and no. Yes, with the plant. So what used to happen with the water would come down the river, they'd have to turn the wastewater treatment plant off because it would be underwater and you can't have that happen. They moved it uphill. But there are still wastewater overflows because people flush stuff down that they shouldn't flush. They put oil and rags and... I one time sat in on a civil engineering class, and the guy that was teaching the class says, in wastewater treatment, the biggest problem is sticks and rags and oil. So, you know, when you take that cooking oil and you send it down the drain...
You mean like tree limbs and...
Even little sticks. Little stuff goes down into... Well, and plus the other thing is that Valdosta has their stormwater system is connected to their wastewater system. And part of what they did was to separate them so that stormwater doesn't go through the wastewater treatment part. When you have all that stormwater rain coming down, then sticks and leaves and all that stuff has to get sorted out too, and they can have them compartmentalized so that only...
I know they use SPLOST to build...
The plant.
Runs it over.
And I asked them if SPLOST was... they would use SPLOST money to maintain the thing.
No.
They said no, they don't need it, because the maintenance comes from
what the people who use it pay.
Warning sightlights of Georgia.
They call me.
Sign safety equipment.
While back, maybe 2 or 3 years. Their air conditioner had been broke for like 5 years. This is their maintenance.
I'll tell you what he told me.
He had a list, this was in the lab out there. He had a long list.
Not here.
The air conditioner was like 20 years on his list of things to do. And all that stuff had been broken.
What is it?
Years. So what my point was, you got a poor maintenance program.
Well, and part of that is, okay, so water and wastewater are what are called enterprise funds. They're supposed to fund themselves in any municipality. The people who use the system, so they get water from the wells and they put that water down, it's supposed to pay for itself. The county, I know at least, didn't raise their water rates and or their sewage rates for like 10 or 15 years. And then when they finally did it in, what was it, 2009 or
something like that. People were mad.
Oh, they were mad that, you know, you can't double my rate. Nobody wants to pay. So that enterprise fund has to fund that. So it's totally funded on the backs of the utility users in Velasa. There's only so much that they're going to bear. The other thing is, too, that you have to remember, not everybody is connected to both systems. Some people still have a private well, but they're connected to the sewage system. So that's not really clear how they're metered, how much they pay. And then, you know, because we've grown in bits and bobs and not everything is even. So same thing in here in Hayhire. So everybody pays a water bill and a equivalent amount of sewage bill. So they base the sewage bill based upon how much water you use. You're only going to bear so much of that, and then you're going to say, well, I don't want to pay anymore. It's too much. So that's the problem. That fund has to pay for itself.
Over there, stormwater fees.
Right across.
That's equal across the board. Rain falls on everyone's house.
Valdale Road there on the right.
Stormwater fees. I never heard of such a thing.
They wanted stormwater. They wanted a rainwater tax.
Rainwater
that's
tax.
That's according to how many inches fell in certain area for the year they were wanting to save them for runoff. You'd have never heard of
it? No, I never heard of it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that was.
Yeah.
They still trying to push that, too.
Okay.
I lived in Foxborough.
That was called stormwater.
Once the rain falls on your house, your house is a certain square footage.
Okay, but what if you collect the water? So, because one of the things that Valdosta has now for stormwater is Angela Blake is now their stormwater person. Used to be Emily Davenport, but she's there now. She's moved up to a bigger part of water, and Angela is the stormwater person. She's been teaching people how to build rainwater barrels and having seminars to, you know, help to control how much water goes down.
You only gonna catch so much rainwater anyway, and then you can only hold so much. It's according to how much comes down at one time.
Well, and the thing is too, because Valdosta is a metropolitan statistical area, the law says that every piece of property that's commercial anyway has to keep its water on site. So that's why you see them digging detention ponds and then putting big fences around them. Or like at the palace, they built that big cistern underneath. There's all that rock underneath that parking lot. So all the water runs down into that enormous cistern they built under that parking lot.
Where's that at?
At the palace.
What palace?
County building.
The county building.
What about the aquifer feed back there behind the river chase?
Yeah, what about the aquifer feed at the sink at Cherry Creek?
Cherry Creek Sink.
Yeah.
Last time I went down there, there were refrigerators, tires.
And the county owns that property. So the thing is to do, contact your county elected officials. I believe that for Hayhire, that would be Clay Greiner and Scott Bernstein and
good
the
luck.
Chairman. And no, tell them your concern. Now, you might say good luck, but here's the thing. If more and more people start being advocates for our water and our rivers, they'll have to listen. listen to us. They'll have to.
I've been I had to say that for all my life about.
Keep calling them up. Don't give up. Somebody said to me a long time ago when I was maybe, I don't know, 22 years old, she said, oh, you'll get over that idealism. That'll wear off. You'll get to be cynical like the rest of us. Not true. You keep trying. Never give up. Never give up.
Why were they allowed to build down there on Valdeo?
At the swamp, you mean?
No, she's talking about Nelson Hill.
Past Nelson Hill, but they did dig a lot out there.
Oh, you mean at the base housing?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, you can watch those videos back. I've been videoing the county commission for, I don't know, 6 or 7 years now. Watch any of those back and you can see how that came out.
So they don't listen.
They weren't willing to fight the Air Force.
Right. The Air Force is an important employer in our area. You don't particularly want to make them.
I like Barbara's question. Why not? Aren't they elected to represent us?
Yeah, they represent themselves. You know,
thank you.
Okay, well,
they're supposed to be elected to your bid, but they do their own business.
Pretty much on everything. So just
maybe Trump's going to get good.